Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome to this service of worship at Duke University Chapel, whether you are joining us online or here in person. We are delighted that you are connecting with us, no matter how you connect. This morning, our guest preacher is the Reverend Dr. Lauren Winner, Associate Professor of Christian Spirituality at Duke Divinity School. She is an Episcopalian priest and author of numerous books, and we are grateful that she is with us this morning to share God's word with us. And we have already enjoyed the exciting prelude music and are delighted to welcome Duke Chapel's Bach Ensemble under the direction of Philip Cave at this morning's worship service. We are particularly grateful to Anaya Crocker, who stepped in at very short notice to replace our tenor soloist, Aaron Katz, who is indisposed. Also, please join us for our first Chorale Vespers service of the new year, Thursday at 7 p.m. for special music for Epiphany, with and led by the singing of the Duke Vespers Ensemble. As you probably already know, we are going to enjoy a cantata this morning. Following the spoken sermon, we will have a musical message, and we are grateful for that music that we will enjoy this morning. Let us now stand and sing our praise to God, who is our firm foundation.
Thank you.
Our desire is to live as part of God's kingdom. Yet if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. In humility and faith, let us pray together, confessing our sin. Almighty God, who sent a star to guide Magi to the Holy Child Jesus, we confess that we have not followed the light of your word. We have not searched for signs of your love in the world or trusted good news to be good. We have failed to praise your son's birth and refused his peace on earth. We have expected little and hoped for less. Forgive our doubt and renew in us all fine desires so we may watch and wait and once more hear the glad story of our Savior Jesus Christ the Lord. Amen. The psalmist declares, "Happy are those whose help is in the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord their God." Our hope is in God, who became flesh in Jesus Christ, and that is good news of great joy. In the infant Jesus, God is born among us. So friends, hear and believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. As God's forgiven and beloved people, we have a peace that is to be shared. So I invite you now by word or gesture to share the peace of Christ with one another. The peace of Christ be with you.
Please join me in a prayer for illumination, printed in your worship guide. Eternal Father, you gave your incarnate Son the holy name of Jesus to be a sign of our salvation. Plant in every heart the love of the Savior of the world, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Old Testament lesson is from Genesis, the 17th chapter. God said to Abraham, "As for you, you shall keep my covenant, you and your offspring after you throughout their generations. This is my covenant which you shall keep between me and you and your offspring after you. Every male among you shall be circumcised. You shall circumcise the flesh of your foreskins, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and you. Throughout your generations, every male among you shall be circumcised when he is 8 days old, including the slave born in your house and the one bought with your money from any foreigner who is not of your offspring. Both the slave born in your house and the one bought with your money must be circumcised. So shall my covenant be in your flesh, an everlasting covenant." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please join in responsively reading Psalm 146, printed in the worship guide. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, O my soul. I will praise the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praises to my God all my life long. Do not put your trust in princes, in mortals, in whom there is no help. When their breath departs, they return to the earth. On that very day, their plans perish. Happy are those whose help is the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord their God, who made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that is in them, who keeps faith forever, who executes justice for the oppressed, who gives food to the hungry. The Lord sets the prisoners free. The Lord opens the eyes of the blind. The Lord lifts up those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous. The Lord watches over the strangers. He upholds the orphan and the widow. But the way of the wicked he brings to ruin. The Lord will reign forever. Your God, O Zion, for all generations. Praise the Lord.
The gospel lesson is from Luke, the second chapter. When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told them. After 8 days had passed, it was time to circumcise the child, and he was called Jesus, the name given by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
In the name of the triune Lord, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God and mother of us all, amen. In paintings of the circumcision of the infant Jesus, and although in artistic depictions of the crucifixion, Jesus almost never appears circumcised, there is a tradition of painting the circumcision event itself, paintings by Rubens, Fra Angelico, Durer. In those paintings, Joseph is sometimes shown performing the actual rite, making the actual cut. Mary is often peripheral to these paintings. In the Rubens, she's looking away, as though she might pass out if she sees the snipping. But there is some evidence that in the era of Jesus' birth, mothers sometimes performed the circumcision themselves. Contra Rubens, that is how I like to imagine the scene the Gospel of Luke renders in one half verse. Mary serving as the mohelet, the ritual circumciser of her son. In the church calendar, we are celebrating the feast of the circumcision of Christ. Technically, the feast day was yesterday, but we didn't gather yesterday, so we have those readings this morning. And that's what we just heard, the Genesis reading establishing the circumcision of all of the boys of Abraham's descent as the mark of covenantal intimacy between them and God. And then the Luke reading, noting that Jesus was, like any Jewish boy was, circumcised when he was 8 days old. The reading underlining for us that Jesus is part of Abraham's descent, that God did not somehow generically come to earth, but specifically God came as a Jew. God came in an act that continued rather than departed from the choice God made when electing Abraham, the choice to heal the world of its damages through divine intimacy with one small community. During this Christmas season, we don't simply welcome God in flesh. We welcome God in Jewish flesh. God in flesh, marked as the flesh of Jewish sons, has always been marked. The circumcision of Jesus is, I think, a productive topic for the church's reflection. It's a topic that presses us to see something about the characteristics of God. And it's a topic that invites us to scrutinize some of our own ritual practices in the church. When Christians reflect about the circumcision of Jesus, one thing we often think about is baptism. Is Christian infant baptism a more or less parallel rite, we wonder, to circumcision? For what it's worth, I think that a lot of the reflection that Christians have done at the site of that question, the question about the parallels between baptism and circumcision, I think a lot of reflection Christians have done is wrongheaded. For example, if you read sermons preached on the Feast of the Circumcision from almost any point in church history, you will find that in their keenness to connect circumcision and baptism, preachers from Bernard of Clairvaux to Francis de Sales identify Jewish circumcision as a rite for the remission of sin, which is to say that in their zeal to make baptism and circumcision cognate, they start projecting onto Judaism doctrinal commitments external to Judaism's own self-understanding. And further, over the centuries, Christian theologians have done a good deal of anti-Jewish polemic right at the site of that question, arguing, for example, that Christianity is superior to Judaism because Judaism's rite of initiation excludes females, whereas Christianity's ostensibly parallel rite, baptism, is offered females and males both. Circumcision and baptism, in other words, become an instance of Christianity's description of itself as pleasingly universal and its description of Judaism as problematically parochial. So it's a history of reflection rife with error and costly error at that. And so I wade in cautiously. I wade in cautiously. Hear that as you wish. But for what it's worth, when I think about the two side by side, Christian baptism and Jewish circumcision, what I see is not the church's superiority, but our lack. It seems to me a sort of sad thing for Christianity that baptism does not, as Brit Milah covenantal circumcision does, leave our flesh marked. It seems one of many instances of God's more evident intimacy with Judaism, that the intimacy of circumcision marks the flesh, whereas the intimacy of baptism touches but does not mark. Then again, it may be that for Christians, Jewish circumcision is a hermeneutic that can help us exactly see that baptism does mark us every bit as indelibly and irrevocably as circumcision marks the one cut. As Augustine once wrote, we are marked in baptism with marks visible only to God. I wonder if in our resurrected bodies, with our resurrected eyes, those marks will be visible to us as well. Very early on, Christians began the habit of praying with relics, praying, that is, in the company of bones of the saints, or sometimes in the company of a finger of a saint, or a lock of saintly hair, or sometimes praying in the company of objects closely associated with a saint, a given saint's tunic, or perhaps the chains that bound her ankles when the saint was arrested. You would pray in the company of these body parts or associated objects because they were objects of great holiness. They were a concrete way for you and your prayers to be surrounded and sustained by those gone on to glory. And of course, the most precious was to pray in the company of relics associated with Jesus, like a piece of the cross on which he was crucified, for example. But of course, there was a problem. Jesus had ascended, his body is in heaven, and so you could perhaps get yourself near a sliver of the cross, but you couldn't pray near his finger. This was a devotional gap. Then in the Middle Ages, pious Christians realized that there were, of course, certain pieces of Jesus' body not ascended. They began praying near his milk teeth, his baby teeth. And around the 12th century, they began praying near his foreskin. In short order, there were across Europe 12 shrines featuring the foreskin of Jesus, then 14 shrines, 18. Catherine of Siena proposed poetically that the wedding rings nuns wore, rings that marked their nuptials to Jesus, were in fact made of Christ's foreskin. In at least one French town, the mother's milk of the Virgin Mary and the holy foreskin of Jesus were processed outdoors in a parade of prayers thought especially to affect pregnancy. None of this was without controversy. Not all Christians readily accepted the proposed foreskin relics. Some thought that surely when Jesus ascended into heaven, he would have taken all of his various body parts, foreskin and milk teeth among them, along with. In the 17th century, Leo Alatius, keeper of the Vatican Library, proposed that the foreskin might have risen into heaven with Jesus and then might have become the rings of Saturn, which had just lately been seen for the first time through a telescope. Well, why not? There was a long history before Leo Alatius of Christians saying that when a Christian looked out into the world, he should see everywhere the cross. When you look at a ship's mast, or a farmer's plow, or a nose projected from a brow, if you're a Christian, you should see those shapes as cruciform, and their shape not only a mnemonic device, but part and parcel of how the world really is. Broken, but repaired by the crucifixion. I think it is remarkable and right-headed that the Vatican librarian should look through a telescope and for once see not foremost cruciformity, but the election of Israel balming the cosmos. What does it mean for the church to attend, as we so rarely have, as we so rarely do, to the abiding election of Israel? To the fundamental that God chose to heal God's creation first and foremost through intimacy with one particular people at the eastern edge of the Mediterranean zillions of years ago. An answer to that question would take the rest of our lives, but here's a start. It means that God distributes God's grace unevenly, whimsically. Here it swells, there it fades. This is a characteristic of God that is uneasy making, just exactly in the way that flesh can be uneasy making or a sermon about circumcision. This variable dispersal of grace can leave God seeming not charmingly whimsical, but arbitrary. It offends our sense of fairness. It is perhaps the strangest characteristic of a God whose Bible testifies to much that is strange. But I think the Bible's leaving us puzzled about this characteristic of God is a good thing. It's a gift. It means, at least, that however else we may try to fashion God into this or that shape that pleases us, if we're paying attention to Scripture, we won't be able to turn God into an 18th century democratic theorist, though how convenient it would be if we could. I want to digress for a minute. Right after this sermon, we are going to listen to a Bach cantata, one Bach wrote for New Year's Day. I don't know about you, but I'm super excited about this, but I'm also a little worried about it. I always get worried about such magical music in the middle of a church service because I don't know how to listen to it. I find myself slipping out of church mode or whatever I think church mode should be and into concert-going mode. So in preparation for being here this morning, I read an article by the early modern musical historian Bettina Farvig. This article is all about how to listen to Bach's sacred cantatas. And it turns out that all the Lutherans of Bach's own time, well, not all the Lutherans, but a lot of the Lutherans of Bach's own time were also worried about how to rightly listen to a cantata in church. They hoped, as one Lutheran pastor put it in 1717, that congregants would listen from beginning to end with attention, but in fact, they thought some only listened so ebenhin ein bisschen, a little bit, superficially. They wanted congregants to be able to understand and think about the words that were being sung, but they worried, in the words of another pastor, that congregants hear nothing other than someone tearing the text apart with a coloratura or a trill, now a small boy whimpering or crowing like a cockerel, now the whole mob crying together like hunters at the hunt, alongside there is fiddling, reed playing, drumming, trumpeting, and sounding and roaring in multifarious ways so that not a single word of the text is understood. In this article, Bettina Farvig argues for what she calls distributed listening. This is how we can listen now, she says, to these cantatas, and it might be how some Lutheran churchgoers listened then. In distributed listening, you're not aspiring to paying rapt, unbroken, numinous attention. You are, rather, distributing your listening. You might distribute your listening variously between words and then instruments. You might distribute your listening between a moment of more intense listening and less focused listening. Your emotional response to the music might also distribute itself along some affective register, listening with an energetic joy at the opening of this cantata, and then with the more pensive suspension during the recitative. This distributive listening, Farvig suggests, is how most of us actually listen. And it would be a mistake to even aspire to some flat and unvarying rapt attentiveness. Of course, you now see that this was not really a digression, but a metaphor meant to suggest that we listen the same way that God graces, distributedly. Circumcision appears in Genesis and Luke as an actual ritual embodied act, but it's also all throughout the Bible, Old Testament and New Testament alike, as a literary figure, a trope, a way of talking about what it's like to be changed. Circumcision as a trope for circumscription sometimes. And on the register of metaphor, one body part the Bible metaphorically circumcises is the heart. As when Deuteronomy speaks of the Israelites having circumcised hearts, hearts that because they are circumcised are able to follow God in loving the stranger and executing justice for the widow. Perhaps then it's no coincidence that a heart features in our gospel text, Mary's heart. Mary, who in her Magnificat already revealed herself as one with a circumcised heart, is here described as hearing all that has been said about Jesus and treasuring all that has been said up in her heart and pondering it. That's one thing circumcised hearts can do. They can store up the right kind of treasure. Because of this pondering, Mary is often described as the church's first theologian. That is, she is the first person that Scripture depicts thinking about Jesus in a deep and sustained and leisurely way. When the church talks about her as the first theologian, the church is trying to show us that we might go and do likewise. We, too, might store up what we hear about Jesus, and then we might think about it. We might ponder it. It's interesting that right after Mary begins the work of theology, Jesus is circumcised, or to put that in the admittedly speculative terms I proposed a few moments ago, it's interesting that right after Mary begins the work of theology, Mary circumcises Jesus. For her, to think theologically was to think about flesh. It was to think about how God does not heal the universe in some abstract and flat, indiscriminate wash, but through the particularity that is the election of Israel. And when, all those centuries later, the church took up the practice of praying alongside the relic of the holy foreskin, it was doing likewise. It was pondering God's intimacies exactly at the site of flesh and specificity, exactly suggesting God's presence is distributed, somehow weirdly concentrated in this or that place, in this or that instance of materiality. I hope for you this new year, much pondering. And I hope delight and discovery and maybe even a little discomfort as God leads you to surprising sights of God's presence and revelation. Our next sight of that revelation is this marvelous cantata, about which those 18th century Lutheran pastors were not only churlish and worried, they also said, this music is the closest we get this side of eternity to those angelic choirs we've been listening for all Christmas.
Thank you.
Please stand. Let us pray. We praise you, O God, for all the grace and mercy which you show us in Jesus Christ. We are grateful for Jesus, the Prince of Peace, truly human and truly divine, who is our strong help in life and in death. We are thankful for his incarnation, his earthly life, his teaching and ministry, and above all, his death and resurrection. And on this day, we give you special thanks for the gift of music which communicates these truths to us. And we give you thanks that Jesus taught us to pray, and so we join our voices with all believers, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Go now in peace. Go now to ponder the truths of Jesus Christ, which you've heard in word and in song. Go now to treasure these things in your hearts and let God surprise you in the particularities of your life. And as you go, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all, now and forevermore. Amen.